If you designed a brand new interchange and consistently saw drivers doing this, would you be happy with your design? This interchange in Florida went through a complete redesign 2 years ago, and while you're probably thinking this looks like a fairly normal interchange, when viewed from above, it is pretty normal. But there are a few quirks it has that leave drivers confused and cyclists fearing for their lives. The cause behind these issues applies to every road project and it isn't always taken into consideration in the design. But first, let's look at why this redesign happened in the first place and how this interchange actually works. Before the redesign, the original interchange functioned as a partial cloverleaf interchange, with these two loops creating a weaving zone right here. This typically isn't a desirable design because all of the traffic exiting the highway has to merge into the traffic trying to enter the highway. This creates a stretch of uncontrolled conflict points, which can lead to crashes and cause backups with people trying to weave between each other. So, in an attempt to improve safety and efficiency, this exit ramp was removed, but this entrance ramp got to stay. Another difference is that this northbound exit was previously a free-flowing ramp that would merge into traffic, but that was changed into an intersection controlled by a traffic light. All of these are pretty normal changes, but one change that switches things up a bit is how they divided the lanes going straight at this intersection. The traffic in the right lane is free to continue on as long as their light is green, even if these lanes are red. This was done to allow for two phases to run simultaneously. Since there's a physical barrier here, traffic entering the highway here can move at the same time as this exiting traffic turning left. This makes sense and improves efficiency at this interchange. This concept is actually done in quite a few places, although with a slight twist. At this interchange in Ohio, for example, all of this traffic entering the highway gets separated here by a continuous physical barrier and never has to interfere with exiting or entering traffic. There are these single green arrow lights, indicating to drivers that they can always continue straight in these lanes and won't have interference from any turning traffic. This is because there's an additional loop ramp on this corner that handles all of the traffic coming from this way that would need to enter the highway. In the Florida interchange, there wasn't room in this situation to create an additional loop ramp on this corner without having to acquire more land and demolish businesses, so this is likely why this wasn't done. Therefore, that's why this left turn has to exist, and that's why there's a gap in this barrier. In fact, this is the only time this light ever turns red, as this left turn is the only movement in this interchange that interferes with this traffic entering the highway. However, in theory, anyone could enter this gap when they aren't supposed to, whether that's the traffic going straight thinking they can turn to enter the highway, or traffic that took the wrong exit and wants to re-enter the highway. The design naturally discourages this, with curbs and lanes that channel traffic to where they need to go, but drivers will do some pretty remarkable things sometimes. There's also signs indicating no turning where you shouldn't be, and even this light up do not enter sign that is always illuminated except for the phase of this light that allows for these left turns to go. Overall, I think most people would agree that driving through this is pretty self-explanatory. So, why are maneuvers like this still happening? With any road project, there's more to it than simply the centerpiece of it. Sometimes, a single change can affect traffic way down the road, even if it isn't part of the same project. For example, in an area where a traffic light was converted to a roundabout, it could cause backups at a stop sign controlled intersection down the road, where there's no longer a consistent break in traffic that the traffic light a mile down the road used to provide. Additionally, the way lanes are designated and how signage is applied is a huge part of any project, and this is where the problem for this interchange begins. All of the traffic entering the highway with this kind of interchange configuration needs to be all the way to the right, to either head north by taking this ramp or by continuing straight to head south and proceed through the cloverleaf ramp. There's this sign that indicates which lane goes where, but this is about the only sign that makes sense. Once we start moving back, we get to the point where all of this highway access traffic is diverted off from the through traffic. And if we continue moving back, we see this sign, which is just not true. Access to I-75 north to Tampa does indeed keep right, but the ramp to I-75 south to Naples is in the next lane over. If we back up further, we see the single lane that takes all traffic to enter both directions of the highway. And if we back up to see where the lane begins, we get this sign, which I think is a big culprit of why the confusion occurs. All access to I-75, both north and south, occur from this lane. Telling southbound traffic to just keep right completely skips over the fact that southbound traffic also needs this lane. This is also the first sign on this road indicating any access to the highway. If you're wondering why I haven't mentioned the obvious bike lane problem yet, don't worry, I'll get to it in a bit. Signage is physically a very small part of any project, but it can have a huge impact on driving behavior, which is why it's crucial it's done correctly. The same applies to paint on the road, arguably way more important. Without lane markings, this wouldn't be a road. It would just be a huge piece of pavement. However, since paint and signs are relatively small pieces of a project, that means a problem with lane markings or signage is relatively easy to fix. So, what could be done here? Well, a few things, but first we need to address this bike lane. I think it's safe to say this is not a good design for cyclists. With all highway access traffic having to cross this bike lane going at 50 miles an hour, it's a bit of a shame that this can even be considered bike infrastructure. especially on a new construction project. Then, considering the fact that many drivers are making maneuvers like this because of the confusing design, this goes from being a bad design for bikes in theory to a terrible design in reality. And it's disappointing that this project is a new example of what the state is building and what it considers an acceptable design. However, it leads to an interesting dilemma though, as technically the state can say this project was inclusive of all users since they included bike infrastructure on this project. But if that bike infrastructure is going to put its users in danger, should it even be built in the first place? This is a topic that could be debated in depth in a future video, but in my opinion, no. This bike lane should not be here. Which leads us back to the problem. What can we do to improve this interchange now that it's built? Keep in mind, this is to imagine modifications to the existing infrastructure to show realistic changes that could actually make a difference. There could be better solutions if the entire thing was just demolished. However, that just isn't realistic. The state just spent millions of dollars constructing this, and the political will it would take to completely redo it would be enormous. With that said, the first thing we could do is remove the bike lane and rebuild this sidewalk to become a path with space for both cyclists and pedestrians. Ideally, we want this path to minimize any interference with vehicle traffic. This could be done with creating short tunnels under these side roads for the crossings. However, this isn't always in the budget, especially for minor road modifications. A less ideal but lower cost option could be ensuring crosswalks are well marked for pedestrians and bike crossings. There is some debate on what the proximity of these crosswalks to the road should be. On one hand, placing crosswalks closer to the road like this increases visibility of cyclists and pedestrians for drivers, since they would ideally already be in the line of sight of drivers. However, this isn't always true. For example, a car turning left here might begin their turn and not see a cyclist approaching from this way. On the other hand, if we move the crosswalk further back, it creates space for drivers to be outside of the intersection and focus on the crosswalk. This also reduces the crossing distance for pedestrians and cyclists. For this example though, let's pretend we have the budget for a tunnel, since that would be the safest option. The path could extend across the entire interchange in the same configuration, preferably with tunnels under the entrance and exit ramps. With the bike lane removed from the road and any bike traffic diverted onto the new bike path, the conflict of vehicle traffic trying to enter the highway while crossing the bike lane would no longer be an issue. We could also change the way these lanes are marked to distribute the highway access between two lanes instead of concentrated into a single lane. By having a separate lane for each direction to access the highway, it would give drivers more space and clarity as to where they need to be, and likely aid with some of the confusion that's currently going on. Additionally, signage could change to clearly and accurately reflect which lane goes where. An additional sign could be added further back as well, indicating to drivers ahead of time that all highway access will be from the right of the road. Changes to our infrastructure can encourage a change in behavior, and all change has to start somewhere. Building a single path with some tunnels is never going to fix every problem here, but it is an example of a realistic improvement that would create more options for more people. I'm sure many people living on both sides of this highway see it as an impassable barrier to cross without a car, and that's fair because it was made to cross with a car. Even though there's a bike lane and a sidewalk, there are very few people who would actually consider these viable options, simply because of the perceived danger. Of course, the time it takes to get across this in a car compared to walking or biking will almost always be a factor as well, and some people are always going to drive here, no matter what. But some people might consider biking or walking if they had a safe way to do so. And that's what something like a path like this would do, create an option. Meanwhile, road signs and markings, which are meant to guide and inform, are instead confusing drivers, since they aren't aligning with how humans naturally interpret and respond to visual cues, which leads to an important factor that seems to have been forgotten here, human psychology. After all, humans are the ones using the roads. For infrastructure to work well, it needs to not only function physically, but also consider how people behave. Designs need to take into account that humans get confused, angry, distracted, and sometimes make mistakes. We all perceive differently, and we're going to adjust our behaviors accordingly. What might work on paper doesn't always work with humans, and that's why elements that guide and inform the human aspects of roads, like road signs and lane markings, or bike lanes where people actually feel safe, are so important. These all might seem like minor details to spend time discussing, but minor details are crucial when it comes to any infrastructure project, and thankfully are easier to fix if done incorrectly. Every piece of infrastructure was built from scratch at one point, and it's possible to change it over time. If there's a road in your city that has something wrong with it, there's people you can contact to let them know. If you live in the US, many roads are maintained by your county. However, some cities maintain their roads as well, and most larger roads, like state roads, US highways, or interstates, are most likely going to be managed by your state. There's a few exceptions here and there, but you can easily contact people from any of these agencies And even if they don't own that road, they'll likely know who does. You can also contact people in office, specifically those in local government. These are people like your city council members, county commissioners, and representatives. Sometimes messages to road commissions can have a greater impact if they're coming from those in office. One time I contacted my State Department of Transportation about a highway sign that was installed in the wrong spot. They thanked me for letting them know, and the next day there were crews out there removing the sign. It might sound like a silly example, but it goes to show that change is possible. If you like this video and you're interested in showing your support for the channel, you can pick up a shirt just like this at the link in the description. And I also have a Patreon to help support the channel with exclusive posts and further discussion on some of these topics. If you found this video interesting, check out this video next about a different type of interchange design called a diverging diamond. And be sure to subscribe as I'll have more videos in the future discussing road design and urban planning.